Around 3 years ago, Navy officers witnessed a brutal battle but were told not to participate in it. When they inquire the captain about their lack of action, they are reminded that the situation will be handled by hunters. Initially, low-ranked hunters are engaged in the battle against vile beasts, but as it becomes evident that they stand no chance, S-ranked hunters arrive on the scene and help them. About a decade ago, mysterious portals connecting to alternate dimensions known as gates suddenly started popping into existence everywhere. Behind each of such portals were magical beasts who were too tough to be harmed by the common human weapons used in battle, but around the same time some humans awakened mysterious abilities and went on to be called hunters who fight against the magical beasts. These hunters are now categorized and ranked from S to E groups, which are primarily determined based on their magical powers. Now in the present time, two hunters named Park and Kim discuss mundane life problems. When they notice Sung Jinwoo, they start talking about how he is the weakest hunter in the world. They seem to find it funny that he ended up getting seriously injured while on a relatively easy mission. Sung Jinwoo has made peace with the mockery and his weaknesses. He acts as if he is oblivious to all the noise around him. Interestingly, when Sung is alone, a fellow hunter named Juhi comes to meet him. She is curious about his injuries in the previous mission. Sung explains how S-rank hunters decided to not take healers as they felt that the mission was too easy. Unfortunately, Jinwoo is so weak that he still ends up with serious wounds. Just after they have this conversation, Sung and Juhi, along a team of hunters, is tasked to investigate a dungeon under the leadership of experienced Song Chiyol. When the mission in the dungeon starts, everyone appears to be doing well except for Sung. Junhee has only lost sight of him for a few moments and he gets stabbed in the stomach by a huge sword. His injuries could have been fatal, but luckily uses her healer abilities to help him immediately. While she is fixing him up, Sung notices others fighting and appears to feel inadequate and small. Others have managed to get decent loot from the mission, but Jinwoo does not really have much to be excited for. After the dungeon master is killed, the team celebrates. But before they could turn around and head back, they noticed another dungeon. Usually hunters do not find a dungeon inside a dungeon, so Song is not sure what they should do. In order to decide whether they should wait for official instructions or go ahead and explore the second dungeon themselves, Song takes a vote. Eventually, an equal number of hunters are in favor of or against the decision, and Song ends up getting the deciding vote. Since he has not collected enough loot, he votes in favor of visiting the second dungeon. Even though he almost died a few minutes ago, naturally Junhee is furious, but Sung explains that he voted to go since he desperately needs money. It turns out that his mother is in hospital. Jinwoo also needs money to pay for his sister's education, so his decision does make sense despite the risk. The hunters keep walking until they reach a huge circular hall with several gigantic statues. They get confused as they find no magical beasts there and feel that they should turn back. Junhee suddenly starts shaking and claims that the eyes of one of the statues moved. Sung feels that she is probably imagining things. When a hunter tries to open the gate and leave, a statue moves immediately and executes him with one blow. Everyone's concerned about the statues, including Sung, who is worried about the statue that caught Junhee's attention. The statue shoots a laser from its eye and annihilates a few hunters in the process. Sung questioning if he and his allies will escape this place with their lives intact. Sung Jinwoo successfully protects several members of his party from the deadly laser attack by the Statue of God, resulting in only two casualties. However, their party is deeply shaken by the death and chaos that unfolds in this vicious dungeon. Thereafter, their party leader Song Chiyol discusses strategies with the Sung about how to escape the dungeon. Recognizing that Sung is the only individual capable of deciphering the rules necessary for survival. Scene shifts to a school where Sung Jinwoo's younger sister Sung Jina and her friend Han Song-yi engaging in a brief conversation about Jinwoo and his career as a hunter. Back to the Cardinan Temple, where Jinwoo and Chiyol continue to devise an escape plan from the dungeon. A panicked hunter attempts to escape, but this results in him dying due to the Statue of God's laser strike. This prompts Jinwoo to discern the dungeon's rules, putting his own life at risk to test his theories about the rules. Jinwoo successfully deciphers the first commandment, worship the god. Following Sung Jinwoo's instructions, all the party members kneel before the statue, meeting the requirements of the first rule and successfully averting the laser strikes. Nevertheless, the Statue of God then initiates its next attack. Before Jean Wu can understand the trick to the second commandment, praise the god, numerous party members die after they are crushed under the statue's feet. Despite the initial setback, Jean Wu eventually discovers the key to surviving the second phase. The remaining party members follow the protagonist's instructions again and survive. However, during this time, Jean Wu himself sustains severe injuries and loses one of his legs in the process. Juhi attempts to heal Jean Wu's leg but fails. Concurrently, the dungeon initiates its third attack, accompanied by the appearance of an altar. The group puts all the blame on their captain, compelling Qi Yul to become the sacrifice to fulfill the third commandment, believe the god. Contrary to the group's assumptions, Jean Wu deduces that the altar is not meant for a sacrifice but rather functions as a timer to test their faith. Thus, the remaining members move within the altar's circle. This opens the dungeon gate. Tempted by the opportunity, they all escape, leaving only Jean Wu, Juhi, and Qi Yul behind. Qi Yul proposes himself as the sacrifice, urging Jean Wu and Juhi to make their escape. Nevertheless, Jean Wu insists that he should be the one to stay behind, considering his lost foot and Juhi's immobility due to overusing her magic. As Qi Yul and Juhi make their escape, leaving Jean Wu behind, Jean Wu confronts the harsh reality of his situation, the prospect of dying alone without the chance to see his family again. Frustrated by his own weakness, he yearns for another opportunity to grow stronger, just as the statues unleash a relentless barrage of attacks. Jean Wu attempts to fend off the formidable enemies with just a sword, but his efforts prove futile, leaving him on the brink of certain death. In this pivotal moment, the system emerges in front of him, presenting a secret quest named Courage of the Weak, which holds the key to acquiring qualifications to become a player. The system reveals that if he declines the quest, his heart will stop in 0.02 seconds. In the next moment, Jean Wu regains consciousness in a hospital, surprised to find himself unharmed despite suffering severe injuries previously. While pondering the situation, Wu Jinchul enters Jinwu's hospital room along with Kong Taishik. They are from Hunter Association. Jinchul updates Jean Wu on the current situation. Jinchul goes on to reveal that when reinforcements from the White Tiger Guild and the Hunter Association arrived, they discovered an unconscious Jean Wu, with no traces of the dungeon remaining. Additionally, they also raise suspicion about Jinwu's survival and his potential second awakening as a hunter, a phenomenon that very few hunters experience that allows them to surpass their limits and become an A-rank or an S-rank hunter. However, when they examine his hunter status, there are no indications of a reawakening. After Jinchul's departure, Jinwu discovers the system messages and contemplates their significance. His sister Jaina arrives to meet him during this time. Curious, Jinwu inquires if she can see the system screen, to which she responds negatively. Following Jaina's suggestion, Jinwu opens the message inbox, revealing information about the strength training daily quest. Despite the system warnings about potential penalties for failing to complete the quest, he disregards them. Meanwhile, Jinchul provides a report to Hunter Association President Go, affirming that Jinwu did not undergo a reawakening. Subsequently, the president categorizes the entire incident as a special case. At midnight, Jean Wu faces the consequences as the timer for his daily quest runs out. He is thrust into a dungeon world as part of a penalty quest, where he must survive the poison-toothed giant centipede monsters for 4 hours. Despite being exhausted from constant running and on the brink of collapse, he manages to survive. Scene shifts to 4 days after Juhi got the news that Jean Wu has woken up, and she goes to meet him with some flowers. At hospital, C notices two nurses watching to Jean Wu while doing his training for last 4 days. Jean Wu reveals more information about the system, including recovery skills, ability points, strength levels, and so on. With this, Jinwu's leveling up journey officially begins. Jean Wu receives a quest reward, a key to an instance dungeon. The system discloses that the key can be used at the third exit of the Hapjeong subway station to enter the dungeon. Jean Wu deduces that this is another aspect of his strength training journey. Later, Jean Wu visits his unconscious mother at the hospital. In a flashback, its doctors revealed to his mother's disease, referred to as the final rest. It came into existence with the appearance of gates, and affects roughly 1 in several 10,000 people. Also, at the same time, he awakens as Hunter. Next day, he reaches to subway and enters the dungeon using the key. He realizes it's a different dimension, unlike other dungeons. While initially confident, he begins to waver as the dungeon entrance gets blocked, trapping him inside. The system discloses that he can only exit the dungeon by defeating the boss and using a teleportation stone. Left with no choice, Jinwoo proceeds deeper into the dungeon, pondering whether he can conquer it alone. Soon he encounters three goblins. Despite initial struggles, he ultimately emerges victorious by defeating all three monsters. He realized he has become stronger than before, and next moment another wolf monster, the steel-fanged Lycan, appears. Jinwoo notes that this creature is much stronger than the goblins, and to make matters worse, the monster breaks his only dagger. Confronted with a powerful monster, Jinwoo is overwhelmed with fear, haunted by the traumatic memories of his previous experiences at the Cardinon Temple. Jinwoo soon learns he's a lot stronger and his body feels a lot lighter than he thought. He avoids the attack and lands a punch on the Lycan. He summons the log's inventory menu, pulls out a magic sword, and to kill the Lycan with single slash. Suddenly two more Lycans rush toward Jinwoo as he struggles to pull his sword out of the ground. However, he finds a way to pull it out, resulting in another Lycan's death. The third Lycan retreats and Jinwoo uses the opportunity to relax. He looks at his log's menu and notices his level and stats rose because he endured real combat. Jinwoo approaches one of the dead Lycans to see if they have an essence stone. Unfortunately, it's not carrying an essence stone, but he receives its fang as a reward. He realizes this log's dungeon and the magic beasts differ from the ones found in typical gates. Suddenly a store pops up, but he can't access it because he must be at a higher level. He sells the Lycan fang and receives 20 gold. He questions if that's a lot of money and speculates this instance dungeon is E-rank level at best. He contemplates this dungeon's rules and doesn't know what he should focus on. Suddenly multiple Lycans appear and he engages them with everything he's got. As he slays each Lycan, several level up logs pop up to the point where he earns himself the Wolf Assassin title. He defeats all the Lycans and realizes his sword's nearing its end. The Wolf Assassin title log appears again, this time informing him that he's earned numerous items including a teleportation stone. Jinwoo chooses to continue exploring the instance dungeon. Meanwhile, Juhi receives a phone call from Hunter Association. This person informs her that a dungeon break occurred at the mission she declined to tackle. He says they're in dire need of healers, and after thinking about Jinwoo, she accepts the mission. Meanwhile, Jinwoo killing magic beasts and leveling up in the instance dungeon. Additionally, he notes how the color of the monster's titles indicates their strength levels and how that color can change over time depending on his current level. He travels to a dangerous environment and believes he'll encounter a magic beast that'll provide him with an incredible challenge. While strolling through it, the magic beast attacks him and breaks his sword. The magic beast appears in front of him and he notices its name is colored orange, meaning it's on equal footing with him. He assumes this snake called Kasaka is the dungeon's boss. Although he's unsure how he'll fare against the Kasaka's impenetrable skin, he battles it. During his bout with the Kasaka, he reflects on topics regarding courage, weakness, and strength concerning the experiences he's had over the years as a hunter and citizen. With unwavering determination, he uses his strength to squeeze the life out of the Kasaka. Several log entries pop up informing him that he's leveled up significantly thanks to his victory over the Kasaka. Additionally, Jinwoo receives a dagger that's made out of the Kasaka's fangs and a venom gland. However, he suggests storing the venom gland away since it looks like a terrifying item to use in his eyes. The log sends Jinwoo back to Earth. He stumbles upon a soldier who leads him to the tragic incident. He learns a dungeon break occurred and uses his new perceptive powers to pinpoint the boss's location. At the location, several hunters and healers struggle to combat the dungeon break boss. Jinwoo examines the battle from afar and pinpoints reasons why this party failed to defeat the boss. He notices Juhi struggling alongside this party because she's still shaken up by the god statue incident. Realizing the boss is weaker than him, he chucks his broken sword at it to shatter its defenses. This allows the party to defeat it. One of the members notices Jinwoo's dagger and asks a nearby mercenary if he knows who threw it. Before the mercenary could introduce Jinwoo to him, Jinwoo already left. Jinwoo's shocked he managed to pierce through the boss's defenses with his broken sword, Juhi questioning herself if Jinwoo was the one who threw the sword. Several nurses chatting about Jinwoo's miraculous athletic development. During their conversations, we see Jinwoo performing several exercises from push-ups to squats. One of the nurses tells Jinwoo he'll be discharged from the hospital today. She asks for his contact information and Jinwoo exchanges it with her. Then we cut to an interview between a woman and a male S-rank hunter named Baek Yunho. She asks him several questions regarding his ordinary and hunter lifestyle. Then we cut to Gina watching the interview from home. She notices she's running late and calls out to Jinwoo. Gina glances at Jinwoo and notices he's changed. Jinwoo gives Gina an umbrella and tells her to stay safe. Alone, Jinwoo checks his player log and notices he still needs to complete his daily quest's running task. Then he checks his status and learns he still has points left from his last trial. He questions what stat he should apply these points toward. Afterward, Jinwoo's landlord calls him about his late rent payment. He tells Jinwoo he can hold off on the due date, but Jinwoo insists he can pay him soon. Jinwoo contemplates ways he can earn money swiftly and adequately. Later, Jinwoo completes his running requirement and accepts the rewards for completing his daily quest. Then Jinwoo meets Hwang Dong-suk and gets ridiculed by Hwang's subordinates because of his weak hunter moniker. Hwang calms his allies down and relays intel about what he wants Jinwoo to help them accomplish during their C-rank dungeon expedition. He informs Jinwoo they don't plan to share spoils with him but are planning to pay him a lot of cash for his help. Jinwoo learns that Hwang doesn't have a healer in his party and questions him about it. Hwang says he tends to operate without one, which bugs Jinwoo a bit. Nevertheless, Jinwoo signs Hwang's contract. Then a D-rank hunter named Yu Jinho approaches Jinwoo and says they're after the same prize. Before Hwang and the others enter the gate, Yu's worried if they'll be okay. Jinwoo tells Yu that the gate size doesn't indicate how terrifying the dungeon inside will be. He says the gate's magic power level will indicate if the dungeon will be easy or difficult. As they traverse through this dungeon, Jinwoo gives Yu a rundown on glowstones and their functions. Before Yu asks Jinwoo more questions, Jinwoo tells him to be quiet. Jinwoo uses this chance to listen in on the area sounds to see if he can pinpoint what type of magic beasts they're dealing with. Jinwoo realizes they're dealing with insect types and tells Hwang. Hwang and his allies remain diligent and demonstrate excellent teamwork against their ant foes. Jinwoo praises Hwang and his party but feels they have room to improve. Jinwoo feels something is amiss. Meanwhile, Hwang and his allies seemingly defeat all the ant monsters. He tells his allies to grab all the essence stones so they can split them up. After Hwang praises Jinwoo for his instincts, another ally tells Hwang that this dungeon may harbor a stronger magic beast. Simultaneously, Jinwoo tells Yu to keep his guard up after Yu tells him that his father got him expensive gear for his first raid. After a brief scene involving Beck and other hunters, we continue following Jinwoo and his party members' C-rank dungeon endeavors. Jinwoo is concerned that Hwang's deal is too good to be true. Hwang and the others stumble upon a cave full of mana crystals. He hopes that these crystals will assist him in growing his Dream Strike team. Yu asks Jinwoo for his contract and confronts Hwang about some details regarding it. Hwang says they should focus on transporting the crystals out of the dungeon before fighting its spider boss. Unfortunately, one of Hwang's allies didn't think they'd find a cave full of mana crystals, so he didn't bring the equipment necessary for excavating them all. Hwang tells Yu and Jinwoo to remain here while they return to his comrade's truck to gather the mining tools. Jinwoo contemplates Hwang's earlier sentiments and realizes something's not adding up. As they leave, Hwang tells his ally to seal up the boss's chamber. Yu and Jinwoo realize they've been betrayed, and Jinwoo recalls a comrade's words about several peculiar expeditions. Yu's upset that Hwang and the others betrayed them over mana crystals. Jinwoo tells Yu to stand aside since he plans to combat the spider. Hwang and his party exiting the dungeon, his comrade questions Hwang's plan, but Hwang ensures them that his mana crystal gathering and escaping plan will work. However, someone questions him about the possibility of the spider waking up or remaining awake when they re-enter its lair. Hwang says he'll use Yu's fancy sword and gear to defeat it. Additionally, if all else fails, they'll abandon the mana crystals and sell his gear to a random buyer. Hwang proceeds to look up Yu's family's information so he can show up at Yu's funeral to avoid suspicion. Back at the spider's lair, Yu doesn't believe Jinwoo has the strength to defeat the spider boss. Jinwoo partially agrees and compares this C-rank spider boss to the other bosses he defeated before. Although Jinwoo is concerned, he charges at the spider boss and fights it. Meanwhile, Chairman Go enters a vehicle and engages in a work-related discussion with Wu. Wu informs Go that his schedule's free now and would like to chat with him about things more during this car ride. Back at the dungeon, Jinwoo continues fighting the spider boss. During this time, Yu is speechless by Jinwoo's incredible prowess and wonders if Jinwoo is a false ranker, a hunter who adores the thrill of murder. While Yu's lost in thought, Jinwa's player log informs him that his fatigue stat is rising. Jinwu examines his Kasaka weapon's abilities via another player log menu. He feels its abilities will help him slay the spider boss, especially if he aims for the boss's weak point. Jinwu observes the spider boss closely, and during this observational phase, his player log informs him that received a new dash skill which gives him a 30% speed boost. With it, Jinwu tries to close in on the spider's weak point to damage it. However, his weapon doesn't penetrate the boss's defenses. During the fight, the spider boss knocks Jinwu into a wall, and Jinwu notices his fatigue stats risen significantly. Before the spider boss murders Jinwu, Jinwu notices he has a full recovery item on standby and activates it. With this power and health boost, Jinwu defeats the spider boss by stabbing it repeatedly. While Jinwu reaps a reward from the boss's body, Yu is bewildered by the fact that Jinwu defeated the boss by himself. This fuels his theory of Jinwu being a false ranker. Yu showers Jinwu with kindness, and Jinwu finds his behavior strange. Suddenly, Huang and the others arrive. They're shocked Jinwu and Yu survived and defeated the spider boss. Meanwhile, we cut to Go and Wu sparring in a training area. Wu's impressed by Go's strength, while Go praises Wu for his defensive capabilities. Go gives Wu compelling advice, and we return to Huang and his allies confronting Jinwu and Yu. Huang and his men think the boss is weak, while others argue Yu defeated the beast with his sword and armor. Huang interrogates Yu about his family and his equipment. Yu questions how Huang gathered this information about him. Huang ignores his question and orders Yu to murder Jinwu. Yu chooses to side with Jinwu, so Huang and his allies approach the two with murderous intent. Suddenly, Jinwu's player log informs him about an urgent quest he must fulfill. It tells Jinwu that he must murder the people who want to kill him, otherwise he'll receive an appropriate penalty. While confused by the task, Qiuwan attacks Jinwu, sending him into a pile of mana crystals. We cut to a girl named He Jin who visits a parlor with her friends. They share insight about their current hunter-themed activities. Then we return to the battle between Jinwu, Yu Huang, and Huang's men. Although Jinwu is still conscious, he ponders whether or not he should kill Huang and his men. Jinwu also questions if the player log wants him to survive the ordeal so he can become stronger. Jinwu approaches Huang and his men with killing intent. One of Huang's men approaches Jinwu, and Jinwu beheads him with ease. To Huang and the others' shock, Jinwu proceeds to murder Huang's other men with his Kasaka blade. Jinwu murders all of Huang's men, so Huang increases his power to combat Jinwu. Despite Huang's efforts, Jinwu kills Huang. Jinwu and Yu flee the dungeon. While they discuss with a worker about their dungeon experiences, Jinwu observes his rewards from the human slaying mission. Jinwu can't believe he got rewarded for murdering people. After examining the murderous intent skill he achieved from his human hunt, Yu finishes his conversation with the female worker and thanks Jinwu for his help. Jinwu notices it's raining and states that he's happy he gave Jaina the umbrella. A man presenting manager Wu with documents concerning Jinwu and Yu's dungeon expedition with Huang and the others. Despite the man's concerns about the expedition, Wu isn't too interested to look into it himself. Jinwu returns home with chicken and other delectable food items. Jaina greets Jinwu, and Jinwu tells Jaina that he'll be able to cover their hospital bills and other expenses for a while. Jaina notices something's amiss with Jinwu and asks him if he's okay. Jinwu ensures Jaina that he's alright. Then the player log system informs him that the beverage he's consuming will harm him. Jinwu returns to his room and continues drinking the alcohol. He realizes he's not getting drunk from it and wonders if the player log system's preventing that from happening. Then the player log system tells Jinwu that a reward he earned from the double dungeon is helping him avoid that. Jinwu realizes this is why his limbs grew back after that fiasco. Later, Jaina wakes Jinwu up and tells him that Yu wants to meet him at a cafe. At the cafe, Yu tells Jinwu he's crafting a strike team and would love him to join him on 19 or so dungeon expeditions. Jinwu attempts to leave, but Yu convinces him to stay. Yu confirms he wants to become a licensed guild master. He says he needs 20 raids to achieve his mission, and notes the one he and Jinwu participated in counts as one. He reveals his father wants to put a guild together for business purposes. He particularly wants an S-rank hunter guild master and Yu's brother to serve in a second-in-command role. Jinwu reminds Yu that there are only a few guild masters in the world, with most already being affiliated with a guild. He also questions Yu if his father planned to poach a guild master from a guild. Jinwu feels if Yu's father does that, It'd be a terrible move because he'd draw negative attention to his business. Yu hands Jin Wu a portfolio containing documents about a building Yu's father wants to use for the guild's headquarters. He says its current market value is 30 billion and says he's willing to offer that to Jin Wu if he can help him complete 19 successful raids. Jin Wu thinks this through and declines Yu's offer. Although Yu tries to entice Jin Wu further, Jin Wu departs. Meanwhile, we cut to Huang's brother Dong Su. He asks someone to get him intel on the two people who went on the raid with his brother and his men. A woman named Laura hands Dong Su a document on the incident. Dong Su feels his brother was murdered by someone and asks Laura what would happen to him if he killed someone abroad. After hearing Laura out and discussing his scheduling concerns with Laura, Dong Su hopes Jin Wu and Yu will survive long enough for him to enact his revenge. As Jin Wu and Gina go for a jog, they discuss what she'd do if she had $30 billion. Jin Wu picks up the pace and leaves Gina behind. He checks the player log system and notices he overachieved in his quest's running requirement. Jin Wu questions how high it can go and continues running. Jin Wu realizes the system cuts off at a certain point. Additionally, he notices the daily quest turned into a secret one. Jin Wu checks the awards he earned from this quest. He spots a blessed random loot box item and selects it. Jin Wu opens the box and receives the Demon Castle's key. The item's bio states that it'll allow Jin Wu to enter an S-rank dungeon called the Demon's Castle. If he conquers it, he'll achieve the ingredients for the Elixir of Life, which can cure all illnesses via powerful magic. Jin Wu visits his mother and wonders if this elixir has the power to cure her. He flees to the area that the player log system told him to visit so he can use the key. Jin Wu enters the dungeon and says if things get hasty, he plans to use the teleportation stone he saved from his instance dungeon outing. Jin Wu confronts a magic beast called Hell's Gatekeeper Cerberus. The two fight, but none of Jin Wu's weapons, enhancements, or abilities assist him against Cerberus. Jin Wu notices he still has Kasaka's Venom Gland item in his inventory. Jin Wu selects the item and drinks the concoction. With this item's power and Jin Wu's several eye-stabbing attempts, he successfully defeats Cerberus. After getting healed up, the player log system alerts Jin Wu about some things he unlocked. Jin Wu notices something else popped up too. He selects it and receives a small document-like reward. Then the player log system tells Jin Wu that he must find three items to craft the Elixir of Life. It says he can find these items in the Demon's Castle. Jin Wu knows if he heads into that castle now, he will perish, so he states that he'll investigate the castle at a later time. Jin Wu visiting his mother and reflecting on his experience with the S-rank dungeon, he feels he needs to get stronger before he returns to collect the Elixir of Life's ingredients. Later, Jin Wu meets up with Yu at the cafe and tells him he'd like to accept his 19 C-rank raids offer. However, Jin Wu only wants Yu and him to clear the C-rank dungeons. Yu's distraught by Jin Wu's stipulation since C-rank dungeons require 18 members. Jin Wu says they can hire folks, similarly to what Huang did. Meanwhile, we observe Jin Wu attempting to surpass his requirements for his daily quest. Jin Wu opens his player log and notices it's not counting his extra work anymore. Jin Wu receives an email from the Hunters Association. They're seeking some hunters for a D-rank excursion. Although Jin Wu prefers something better, he's willing to accept the task. Later, Beck visits Choi. Beck is enraged that Choi made him participate in an interview that was meant for Choi. Choi changes the subject and informs Beck about Yu's father's guild building developments. Beck says he knew about Yu's father's plans and wants to know why Choi called him to his office. Juhi reflects on Jin Wu's activities and wants to try harder. She receives a similar message Jin Wu received from the Hunter Association regarding the D-rank mission. Haein visits Choi in his office and tells him she received a business opportunity from a Eugene construction scout. Haein tells Choi she declined their guildmaster offer but wants Choi to elaborate on what he and Beck discussed. We cut to Beck in a bar, reflecting on his conversation with Choi about the failed raid at Jeju Island. Choi is upset that society's forgotten the disaster that occurred on the island unlike himself. He hopes to clear the island in the future and reveals why he needs everyone on the same page. After that, we see Song reunite with Jin Wu. The two catch up briefly and inform each other about their current plans involving the D-rank dungeon summons. Then Jin Wu and Song notice that Juhi, Park, and another individual are participating in this dungeon. Before they catch up, several Hunter Association affiliates and prisoners arrive. one of the associates explains the C-rank prisoners will be joining our heroes on their dungeon expedition as substitutes. She explains they're short on staff and promises these prisoner hunters will be on their best behavior. Kong introduces himself to everyone and promises that he'll keep the prisoners in check. Song asks Jean Wu if he can serve as their leader. Despite what happened during their double dungeon expedition, Jean Wu says he's okay with it. Later inside dungeon, Jean Wu and the others defeating multiple goblin enemies in the dungeon, Song and Juhi praise Jean Wu for his achievements and notice he's a lot stronger than he used to be. Our group continues exploring the dungeon and end up in a situation that offers three pathways. The prisoners and Kong take the third path, and Jean Wu, Song and Juhi take the left path, Kim and his ally take the middle path. While Kim and his ally are battling goblins, Kim ensures his ally they'll be safe on this dungeon outing. Moreover, Kim plans to apologize to Jean Wu for leaving him behind during the double dungeon expedition. Meanwhile, Kang's prisoners ramble about how easy the goblins are to kill. Kong asks them if the prisoners would feel a similar way if the goblins were humans instead. The prisoners tell Kong they wouldn't notice a difference. We cut to a flashback between Kong and a client. This client mentions how it isn't fair that these prisoners were offered a chance to free themselves, given the pain they caused him and his family. He offers Kong $3 billion to kill these men. Kong tells the prisoners that when he departs from this place, he plans to tell the other inspectors that the three perished while fighting 100 goblins. Kim and his ally stumble upon Kong, who is about to murder the final prisoner. Realizing Jean Wu and the others left for the boss room, Kong kills the final prisoner and walks toward Kim and his ally. He plans to murder them to erase any evidence. While pondering his experiences with Kong, Jean Wu overhears someone shout and alerts Juhi and Song about it. The three stumble upon the prisoners' corpses and Kim's ally's remains too. Jean Wu spots Kim's body nearby and asks Juhi to heal him. Kong tries attacking Juhi, but Jean Wu blocks his attack. Song asks Juhi to apply a strength buff on himself. With this buff and Kim's sword, Song fights Kong. Before Kong can murder Song, Jean Wu steps in and confronts him. Jean Wu tells Kong he's an E-rank hunter and Kang's baffled by his remarks. Kong believes Jean Wu's a false ranker or had a second awakening. Additionally, he wonders if Jean Wu is the same kid he and his ally met earlier. Jean Wu and Kong clash, and during the fight, Jean Wu's player log system assigns him with a new human assassination quest. Realizing what he must do, Jean Wu gives his best effort against Kong. However, Kong uses a new assassin technique to catch Jean Wu by surprise. Juhi and Song worry about Jean Wu after Kong brutally uses his technique to injure one of Jean Wu's legs. Jean Wu uses one of his full recovery tools to heal his leg. Kong strikes at Jean Wu, but Jean Wu finds a way to stab him with his dagger, netting Jean Wu the victory over Kong. Jean Wu interrogates Kong after their fight. Kong questions how Jean Wu achieved this level of strength despite being an E-rank hunter. Jean Wu tells him he'd like to know himself. Juhi and Song thank Jean Wu for his help. Jean Wu tells the two to exit the dungeon and to let him handle the dungeon boss. Later, Wu and a dungeon supervisor head to the dungeon's location. Wu can't believe Kong was filled with killing intent. Additionally, Wu is shocked by Jean Wu's appearance. Wu asks the three who killed Kong. Although Jean Wu is concerned, Song steps in and says he killed Kong and credits Juhi for helping him do so. Jean Wu examines Wu and realizes he's an A-rank hunter. Juhi shows Jean Wu an essence stone, asking if he remembers it. Juhi and Jean Wu taking a stroll in the park. During this stroll, Juhi tells Jean Wu she's not over the fear she obtained from the double dungeon expedition. Also, Juhi feels she should be tackling higher ranked dungeons, however she opted for lower ranked ones instead. Juhi offers Jean Wu her essence stone and tells him she plans to retire and move back in with her folks. Later, Jean Wu visits Yu, and Yu introduces Jean Wu to their strike team. Jean Wu's taken aback by the fact Yu hired drunks and a minor. The minor confronts Jean Wu for his offhand comment toward her. Jean Wu tells her and the others that they'll be waiting outside. He and Yu plan to raid the dungeon alone. One of the hunters questions the stipulations Yu and Jean Wu set in motion. Yu ensures the hunter that he'll be paid. Several hunters wonder if it was the right move to let the two explore the dungeon alone. During this spiel, we learn from Jaina that the miner who took on Yu's offer was a classmate named Song Yi. After an hour passes, the strike team wonders why Yu and Jean Wu haven't returned yet. Suddenly Jinwoo and Yu exit the dungeon and the strike team is surprised that they achieved victory. After several level-ups and dungeon expeditions, Yu notices Jinwoo's becoming stronger over time. While tackling a dungeon, Jinwoo notes how useful his new stealth skill is along with his other ones. While resting, Jinwoo contemplates if he should tackle the Demon Castle mission. Suddenly the player log system informs Jinwoo about a job change quest. We cut to a Hunter Association office building. A man named Kitchell hands his manager on a document. In it, On learns that someone is spending $150 million on C-rank dungeon gate ownership. Moreover, On learns Yu and Jinwoo are running this charade. On wonders if Jinwoo is the same Jinwoo who participated in the double dungeon expedition. Jinwoo and Yu exit the dungeon. Jinwoo asks Yu if he can take the day off. Yu says he can put the gates he purchased for them to tackle on hold for 2 days. We cut to Guildmaster Choi waking up from a Jeju Island nightmare. He looks at the document on his desk and says it's almost time to initiate his reconnaissance Jeju Island mission. Later on, and Kitchell approach Jinwoo. On introduces himself as the White Tigers Guild's second administration team manager. On and Jinwoo enter the cafe. On wants Jinwoo to join the White Tigers Guild. Jinwoo declines On's offer. Before Jinwoo departs, he asks On who informed him about him. On admits that he searched for information on Jinwoo due to dungeon market complications. On promises Jinwoo that he or his ally won't ramble about Jinwoo to others. Jinwoo appreciates On's gesture and offers On ownership of 3 of their C-rank gates. If he refuses, Jinwoo says he and his guild should forego entering any C-rank dungeons in the future. On and Jinwoo agree, and Jinwoo uses one of his potions to heal On's wound. Jinwoo and Yu chat about the gate and cash exchange. Then we cut to several White Tigers Guild employees reacting to the news about owning the 3 C-rank dungeons. Kitchell informs On about this development, and On can't believe Jinwoo scammed him. Although On slightly bitter about the ordeal, he's happy he got Jinwoo's contact information. Jinwoo visiting a location and accepting his job change quest task. Suddenly a purple portal appears in front of Jinwoo, which he then enters. We cut to Yu and his father in a dining area. Yu's brother Jin Jinwoo greets Yu's father. We return to following Jinwoo, and he finds this job change quest's dungeon peculiar. His player log informs him that he can't use his full recovery skill or any potions. Also, Jinwoo must conquer the dungeon to escape it. Jinwoo encounters a knight. He toys with it for a while and uses his fatal strike skill to defeat it. More knights arrive to challenge Jinwoo. We return to following Yu, his father, and Jinsung. Yu's father asks Jinsung how his S-rank hunter recruitment plans are going. Jinsung says several hunters turned him down, but he has some negotiations underway with European and Middle Eastern hunters. Jinsung turns to Yu. He knows about Yu's current C-rank dungeon buying ploy. Jinsung tells him not to get in his way. We shift to following Guildmaster Choi. Choi meets up with Cha Hae-in and other hunters near an aircraft. We return to observing Jinwoo, who has successfully defeated his enemies. His player log informs him that he's obtained some armor and he equips it. Jinwoo enters a new room and encounters a red knight figure inside it. The knight's title appears in front of Jinwoo, informing him that the knight is called Igris the Bloodred. Igris and Jinwoo duke it out. Igris overwhelms Jinwoo, and Jinwoo wonders how he can penetrate Igris's defenses. Jinwoo plans to fight Igris in hand-to-hand combat. Igris tosses its weapons aside, and Jinwoo wonders if Igris is downplaying him. Meanwhile, Wu visits Chairman Go. The two discuss their respective workloads briefly before Choi calls Go on the phone. Go asks Choi if everything is going well, and Choi says it is and thanks Go for approving his upcoming operation. Go says it's no big deal and wishes Choi and his squad the best at Jeju Island. We return to following Jinwoo and Igris's fight. Jinwoo is overwhelmed by Igris's might. Jinwoo decides to increase his speed stat to see if it'll assist him in this battle. Unfortunately, this doesn't bode well for Jinwoo and results in him getting tossed around like a rag doll. Jinwoo sitting on Igris's chair while Igris is looming over him. Igris summons his sword and tries to murder Jinwoo. Jinwoo grabs the sword, tosses it aside, and summons his blade to stab Igris's eye. While Igris is immobilized, Jinwoo pushes Igris to a nearby wall and starts stabbing him multiple times. The player log pops up and informs Jinwoo that he defeated Igris. Suddenly more portals and player logs appear around Jinwoo. Jinwoo wonders if he's facing infinite enemy waves now. Although Jinwoo has to fight numerous enemies, He realizes they aren't on par with Igris regarding strength. Jinmu charges at the knights, meanwhile Choi and his allies leave for Jeju Island. Simultaneously, Jinmu's putting up a decent fight against the horde of knights, however he wonders how long this will last. Jinmu knows he may not be able to keep this up for long. He tries using his teleportation stone, but one of the knights knocks it out of his hand. While Jinmu is combating the knights, he knows he's running out of methods to defeat them. He starts hearing words echoing through his ears about people claiming that he's a weak hunter and should quit while he's ahead. Suddenly the player log appears before Jinmu, reminding him that he must complete his daily quest. Since Jinmu can't complete the quest, the player log system transfers him to the penalty zone. Jinmu arrives at the penalty zone and reflects on what happened to him. Jinmu summons items from his store and drinks them to heal himself from the wounds he sustained from that job change quest dungeon. Several centipede monsters arrive and Jinmu notices they're all on equal grounds with him regarding their title card's color. He combats the centipedes, he defeated them all, leveled up, and significantly recovered from his wounds. Jinmu opts to check out the system store first. He stumbles upon a night killer weapon and purchases it. Jinmu grabs the blade and crushes the rune stone he obtained after he defeated Igris. The player log appears. Jinmu notices he's obtained the skill Ruler's Hand. This skill doesn't require mana and will allow Jinmu to physically manipulate objects without touching them. Jinmu returns to the job quest change dungeon. He notices there are more knights in the room than before. Meanwhile, someone informs Guildmaster Choi and his allies that they'll arrive in the airspace over Jeju Island shortly. They senses multiple mana sources from the ocean's depths and informs Choi and the others about it. Jinmu examines the warriors he's combating on the battlefield. He realizes the mages are summoning knights to the battlefield via magic portals. This entices Jinmu to target the mages instead. After Jinmu defeats another mage, the remaining mages huddle together. They use their powers to transform their remaining knights into a golem. Despite the mages' efforts, Jinmu defeats them and conquers the golem they created afterward. The player log appears and informs Jinmu that he finished the job change quest. Then the player log tells Jinmu his new job class is a necromancer, and Jinmu is puzzled by this. Jinmu doesn't like the sound of that. He wants a job class that's more of the strength variety. The player log asks Jinmu if he wants to accept the job. Jinmu tries to reject the offer, but the player log tells him it's a hidden class. After thinking it over, Jinmu accepts the job. This job class is called Shadow Monarch. Also, Jinmu notices he's obtained several awards and wonders if the entire quest is done now. Several shadows crop out of the knights Jinmu defeated. The player log asks him to input a command word into its system for his shadow extraction skill. Jinmu chooses Arise. Ghostly knight figures rise from the knights. Jinmu wanders to Igris's body and learns he can extract his shadow. Jinmu tries extracting Igris's shadow but fails. The player log says he has two more attempts left. Jinmu tries again and fails. Jinmu tries persuading Igris to join his side and abandon his former master. This time Jinmu successfully extracts Igris's shadow. The player log asks him to give Igris a new name. Jinmu gives Igris his name. Igris and the other Shadow Army members bow before Jinmu. Jinmu tells Igris and the others that they're with him now. We cut to Choi and Heian observing one of Jeju Island's magic beasts on their ship, and Choi mentioning that the magic beasts are evolving somehow. And that's the end of anime. Please do like and subscribe if you enjoyed it.